Welcome back, everyone, to theCUBE studios here in Palo Alto, California. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. This is our Crypto Trailblazers series. This is theCUBE's feature performance partnering with the NYSE Wired community founded by Brian Bauman, an open community where people get together around content, share their perspectives with you, and of course, bring insights to the marketplace. And the Crypto Trailblazers are laying down the commentary. The leaders coming together, the Ethereum Foundation's in town from the, in the Bay Area at Stanford and Berkeley, and a lot of great action weighing in on the future of infrastructure and the applications that will run on it, bringing business to the crypto blockchain. It's a wave that's undeniable. Matt Katz is here, he's a co-founder of Caldera. Matt, great to have you on theCUBE. You're in SF, good to see you. Welcome, coming down to Palo Alto.
Yeah, thanks for having me, John.
You guys are doing some stuff in the cloud, crypto. Explain what you guys do, then we can get into it.
Yeah, so at Caldera, you can kind of think of us as like an AWS for building your own blockchain. So when you're a blockchain developer, you basically have two choices. You can build on a public blockchain, right? Deploy your smart contracts to Ethereum or Solana, et cetera. Or you can build your own blockchain. And this has been a choice that a lot of teams have historically made, you know, throughout the entire history of the industry. But, you know, go back like 5 years ago, it was incredibly expensive. You need to hire a team of at least like a dozen protocol engineers, coordinate at the very least dozens of external parties to run nodes to launch your chain. We basically simplify that just like AWS, like one click, deploy your own chain, and then you have like a fast sovereign environment for your application.
Yeah, and AWS has certainly made it easy to stand up with serverless, all kinds of higher level services, all that good stuff. All right, so the catalyst is, I want my own blockchain. I want to control it. I want a value on it. How do I do that? Is it a buy build decision? Is it labor? What's the value proposition? And then secondly, does it work with the existing public chains?
Yeah, so it's definitely like a buy build decision. Just like in, you know, the cloud, you know, industry, like the space has kind of evolved over time. Before, you probably needed to write the entirety of the code base from scratch. Then you had like SDKs, which, you know, made it easier, but like you're still ultimately needing to engineer the thing. And now you have what we provide, which is a very high level service, right? Sort of like Vercel, where you get everything out of the box. So both building the chain, you know, actually creating the software for that chain, we help with, and then the actual infrastructure of running that chain. And that's often the harder part, right? You need to make sure, you know, blockchains, they can't go down. That's the whole premise, right? Yeah. So you need to keep them highly available, highly online, scale up RPC nodes that developers use to communicate with. We provide a lot of external services to provide more visibility to the data on these chains, et cetera. You know, basically you get like the whole thing out of the box.
So it's basically, you said AWS for blockchain, you're provisioning blockchain for people.
Literally.
That's the bumper sticker.
Yes.
All right, so take me through how that works. Is the use case because they want control, ease of use? I get that whole provisioning piece. Mm-hmm. Is it blockchain? So is it Ethereum? What is it?
Yeah, maybe I'll take that in reverse order. Yeah. So the chains that we specialize in, they're layer twos, AKA rollups. Mm-hmm. So they're basically highly compatible chains that are built on top of Ethereum that are settled onto and secured ultimately by Ethereum. And so that model makes it really easy for us to offer this as a service. You know, traditionally blockchains, you need to have maximal decentralization from the get-go. That makes it really hard to provide something like this as a service because fundamentally it's not a technology problem, it's a massive coordination problem.
Yep.
With this current model that we have, layer twos, which was pioneered by Optimism, Arbitrum, ZK Sync, et cetera, you can launch a chain, you can have the production of blocks be centralized, and then you have a cryptographic proof mechanism to ensure that the blockchain is operating correctly, and that's you know, settling on Ethereum. You know, with that, you both get a lot of compatibility with Ethereum, so developers get an environment they're used to, and you also have a lot of the ability to bridge assets trustlessly between Ethereum and these chains.
Yeah, Matt, this is, brings up a lot. This comes up a lot. We actually had Arbitrum on earlier yesterday. Layer two comes up a lot now, and rollups is the term that's used a lot. Ethereum, obviously, layer one. For the folks out there that are technical, old school computer scientists, or people who know the old stacks, mm-hmm. layer one, physical layer, talk about the layer one, two dynamic and roll up specifically, and explain that to folks that they can understand why it's relevant in Ethereum and on top with what you're doing. Because, you know, one of the things that's coming out of the Ethereum conversations is that, you know, value creation performance has been gaining, mm-hmm. usage is up big time. Composability is a major feature. Developers love this. So
yes.
If you're a developer, this is a dream scenario.
Totally.
Explain the layers of the stack, so to speak.
Yeah.
Physical layer one, layer two, and this roll-up concept of what it means.
Totally. So I actually think it doesn't, I wish it did, it doesn't map as nicely onto like traditional tech in this regard as I would like. But fundamentally, like the problem with blockchains is you're trying to kind of have like a shared root of trust, right? You're trying to achieve global consensus on some data and some state. And so that's what the layer one provides, right? Ethereum, when you talk to people at like the Ethereum Foundation or the early contributors to Ethereum, oftentimes like they're thinking about like nuclear war level scenarios, and they want Ethereum to still remain online at that time. So Ethereum has actually done a really, really good job at that use case, being a shared, like indestructible layer of trust for state and data. What Ethereum hasn't done amazingly well at as a base layer, because it wasn't their focus, was like speed and scalability. Fundamentally, when you're building a distributed system, you're either distributing that system for scale, so you're distributing workloads to like the different nodes in the system, or you're doing it for redundancy. And Ethereum has chosen the redundancy path. So every single
by rightfully so, right? That's their goal.
Totally, totally. And so it's a highly inefficient system. Every single node in the system needs to process every single transaction and store all the data on the entire blockchain. That's great for a lot of applications, but if you're building a game or you're building a high frequency, exchange or anything, a social media app on chain, you basically, like, it's just way too expensive. It's unfeasible for you to build that on the Ethereum base layer. And so as a community, the Ethereum space built up this concept of L2s, which are run separately. They post data to Ethereum, but that data actually eventually expires, so the nodes don't need to store it forever. And they process computation off of the layer one system, and they just prove that computation is correct. And that proof is much faster and easier to process than all the computation on those layer two chains. And so with that, we're able to actually horizontally scale the ecosystem rather than trying to vertically scale.
Yeah, horizontal scale is a feature for, like, say, cloud.
Totally.
Okay, we've seen that as a great enabler.
Exactly.
All right, talk about the roll-up. What does roll-up mean? I mean, that's a term that's kicked around. Is roll-up is just on top of one, or is it a series of other things?
Yeah, you can think of a roll-up as a blockchain, again, that processes the computation of that blockchain in a more like centralized or off-chain way, and then proves that that's correct to a layer one, like Ethereum. And so that's done either via like a zero knowledge proof, basically using advanced cryptography just to say, hey, like this new succinct like hash of the state is actually equivalent, and we can prove it to all these transactions which occurred before. Or there's optimistic roll-ups like Arbitrum that take a more kind of game theoretic approach. But ultimately, you're doing the same thing. You're proving off-chain computation onto a base layer like Ethereum.
Explain the skeptic's view of, or someone who might not understand what this is.
Yeah.
Well, isn't that not really on-chain because it's in the cloud? If that cloud goes down, I don't pay my bill. Mm-hmm. What's the immutability feature of that? Or does it matter? Is that a moot point? Is that misinformation? Explain that piece of it, because the benefit of saying being on chain is for all the reasons you talked about. Immutability, resilience, great features. But if I'm going to be pointing to a database or a store, if you have a layer two or a roll up, how would you respond to that?
Yeah, and so there's been a lot of effort in the roll up ecosystem to basically create quote unquote escape hatches for these worst case scenarios. So if the chain totally goes down, because all the software is open source and it's public and the cryptographic proof mechanism is all available, like anyone can come in and basically act as that roll up. And because a lot of the data is still posted publicly and is available, anyone can reconstruct the state of the chain. So you get a lot of the
benefits, resilience features.
The resilience features that you would come to expect with blockchains. But you're right. I would think actually one of the great benefits of rollups is that it's a truly pragmatic approach to scaling blockchain. Like, just like how every application doesn't need maximum resiliency, maximum decentralization, like rollups find a really good middle ground there. And so for a lot of the more traditional companies looking to enter blockchain, we're seeing that they're a great option.
It's almost like, the way I would think about, again, just riffing here on this, I think it's an important point, is that you get the cost-benefit advantage because you mentioned cost. I mean, think about to run a distributed system on-chain, scope those costs or the complexity involved by not having rollups?
Yeah, so without a rollup, you're probably launching your own L1 like Ethereum. There are development costs. You'll build it with something like the Cosmos SDK. What we've seen historically is teams that do this, they need to raise tens of millions of dollars, maybe hire, you know, dozens of engineers, right? That's already, you know, single digit millions of dollars at least to create that chain. And then once the chain's launched, well, you need to decentralize it. And so a lot of these teams that are launching these alt L1s, they're rewarding the miners or the validators on their network, oftentimes inflating their token supplies by like 10% or more per year, just to reward those miners and those stakers to get security for their chain. So for a lot of these chains that are launching that are at like, you know, billion-dollar valuations, they're literally paying hundreds of millions of dollars a year to secure their chain, when with a roll-up, you can do it basically by just paying gas fees to Ethereum, which is much, much, much less, like literally orders of magnitude.
That's awesome. A little bit of a sidecar masterclass here, Matt, appreciate it. Just one final point on before we get into some of the things you're working on.
Yeah.
Market Ethereum, I mean, I call it Act Two because there's still momentum here. It's a movement.
Yeah.
I mean, it's clearly developers love it. What's the vibe growth-wise? And not necessarily numbers, but just the vibe, participation. Can you share in scope or help us understand the momentum in Ethereum from developers and or builders?
Yeah, I think Ethereum does really well when people are truly optimistic about the technology. That's how it's been positioned. You know, that's the kind of culture that the space has cultivated. And so from what we're seeing is like, obviously price has been pretty down, you know, over the last few weeks, but a lot of builders are really looking to actually come in and build really cool stuff on Ethereum, right? Whether that's institutions, I know you had a lot of folks on here that are working with them. Gaming we're seeing as a huge category that's picking up, you know, social, consumer
These are platforms, not just apps. See, SaaS was apps on the cloud.
Exactly.
Platforms are coming on this.
Exactly. Yeah, and Ethereum is actually the best place for people to build platforms.
Yeah.
So I think like all of that is really encouraging. For us as well, like our growth metrics are great. Obviously the value on our chains has dipped a little bit with the market because it's all denominated in ETH or altcoins. But like in terms of the number of teams that are looking to launch their own chain and build real cool things, like it's only going up.
And if you look at all the major, you mentioned gaming and social apps, they're all on Amazon Web Services. I mean, but they're not blockchain.
Yeah.
So League of Legends, Fortnite, they're all up there. I mean, because why wouldn't you? It's efficient.
Yep.
So they're now going to move to a blockchain because there's benefits that the cloud doesn't have.
Totally.
What are those benefits?
Yeah, so on the blockchain side, I think the kind of first order benefits are to create you know, more liquid markets for assets. And I think this is something that gaming companies actually really want. I worked very briefly in the mobile gaming sector myself, and it's in many cases like kind of a miserable industry. You're trying to extract max value from a very, very small percentage of users. I think the company I worked for, like maybe a tenth of the revenue was from a single like Saudi prince. You know, that leads to really poor gaming experiences for a lot of users. And what we're seeing right now with a lot of kind of user generated content, gaming companies, right? Think like a Roblox. There's really a focus on building like actually kind of healthy in-game economies that closely mirror the real world economy where you can actually create value in-game for other players. And then when you think about that, like-
And have a marketplace too.
Exactly, exactly. So you have a marketplace and then the gaming company almost becomes like the government, which is a great business, basically taking a tax on every little thing. And
a small tax, by the way, not very massive, but in the aggregate, it's massive.
Exactly. And so blockchains are a great substrate for that, for a lot of, you know, clear reasons. And so we're seeing a lot of gaming teams approach us. And
you know, I think social is going to be there next because, you know, everyone knows the tagline with Facebook and now Meta, that you're the product.
Yeah.
You know, the users of the product.
Yeah.
Not the customer and your data. And so when with tokens, they're the product and the revenue too. They get the revenue.
Yeah.
Facebook gets all the revenue.
Yeah.
So again, that's to me, am I getting that right?
Yeah.
In terms of the kind of the concept of with a gaming that would be hosting on something, but now they get rents in new ways to monetize.
Exactly.
From the architecture and then layer two and the rollups.
Yeah, that's totally correct.
All right, so that's about it. All right, let's talk about your company. When were you guys founded? What's the vision? Share a little bit about your company.
Yeah, so we were founded about 3 years ago, exactly March of 2022. At the time, my co-founder and I were students just down the road at Stanford. We're really, really excited about the possibilities of crypto. But when we thought about all the applications we wanted to build, right, things like gaming, things like social, my first ever project on Ethereum was like an on-chain version of Reddit. Like, we realized that, like, you just couldn't build that sort of thing. It would be way too expensive. You would cap out at like 1,000 users. And so we just thought, okay, well, if the infrastructure doesn't exist for like massive applications, we need to build it because, you know, candidly, I don't think anyone else would.
Yeah, I mean, it's a huge opportunity. Exactly. All right, give some numbers. What are you guys seeing for performance? Can you share any stats?
Yeah.
Put a plug in for the company.
Yeah, so each of our chains can do about 100 million gas per second, which is a, you know, an Ethereum metric basically, you know, describing computation. What that translates to in practice is thousands of transactions per second per chain. But we can launch basically infinite chains horizontally. So unlike a lot of other ecosystems, right, like a Solana, which is very scalable but taps out, like we can process like an infinite you know, number of transactions effectively if we shard across multiple chains, right? That idea of horizontal scaling. We currently are running 30 chains about on ETH mainnet. We account for about a quarter of all layer twos and layer threes that are on Ethereum right now. Yeah. And at peak, as mentioned before, we secured about $2.5 billion of value on our chains.
Yeah, and that's all, and by the way, this idea of scale horizontally is a huge concept, and you know, auto scaling is a hot topic in the cloud.
Yeah.
That's moved the needle. Is there an area you see that's a needle moving moment for your business, for folks looking at the chain? Obviously performance is there. On the developer side, what action do you have there with developers? What's the needle moving environment? Is it just ease of use, developer productivity, security? What's the key, the breakthroughs?
Yeah, for us, we call it like the three S's, like speed, sovereignty, and scale, right? When you have your chain, as I mentioned, it's very scalable. You have you have speed. You also scale, there's a cost element to this as well. Your cost per transaction is maybe orders of magnitude lower. And then under sovereignty, that's where a lot of the fun stuff happens. For example, one of our customers, Kinto, they have baked in like a know your customer system onto their chain. So they can provide kind of semi-regulated finance in an on-chain environment that's easy for developers to build DeFi native applications on, but they can still get some assurances that users are
you're bringing crypto native capabilities
exactly
to people instantly, and exactly you're leveraging the cloud like a lot of other companies have, and a lot of companies that were in SaaS are now doing platforms.
Yeah.
Platforms is what you're doing.
Exactly.
Well, Matt, thanks for coming on theCUBE. You're trailblazing. By the way, Stanford hosted a great event. I went to the dinner last night. Stanford and Cal and Berkeley were doing some great meetups, great community activity. A lot of people are super stoked about what's going on, and congratulations.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming on theCUBE. All right, I'm John Furrier here inside theCUBE. We are in Palo Alto. I'm your host. Crypto Trailblazers are bringing all the innovation, the leaders across the industry. You're starting to see a developer builder mindset move in. Of course, there's money, there's tech money and impact. So blockchain is the new critical infrastructure emerging fast. Kind of like how AWS was 20 years ago. You're starting to see the momentum. Of course, we got it all covered for you here at theCUBE. Thanks for watching.